The word ekphrasis comes from the Greek for the description of a work of art produced as a rhetorical exercise. It is a vivid, often dramatic, verbal description of a visual art piece.
Edvard Munch is considered one of the pioneers of expressionism, an artistic movement that sought to convey subjective experiences and emotions through distortion, exaggeration, and vivid color. His innovative artistic style and subject matter challenged traditional conventions and paved the way for several modern art movements. We'll get to know him a little bit better, but first, let's get into some art news. So, artists are struggling in London. Nearly a third of artists said they might have to give up on their careers within 5 years because of a lack of funds, according to a report by England's affordable studios provider Acme. About half of the interviewees said they could not save money or contribute to a pension plan, and only 12% said they could support themselves through just art. It is like a hostile environment now, said London-based artist Gail Chong Kwan. Read more up on that at The Guardian. Angelina Jolie is moving into Basquiat's old studio. The Oscar-winning actress will take over the space located at 57 Great Jones Street as part of an 8-year commercial lease for her creative venture, Atelier Jolie. A real estate agency, Meridian Capital Group, confirmed this. Andy Warhol and Jean-Michel Basquiat lived and worked at the Manhattan property, which has 6,600 square feet of space spanning 3 floors. All right, well, I don't know what this Jolie, what is this property creative venture, Atelier Jolie, what is that? Let me quickly do a search here. What's she up to here? Atelier Jolie is a place for creative people to collaborate with a skilled and diverse family of expert tailors, pattern makers, and artisans from around the world. Okay, still keeping it in the art realm of a different sort, you know, fabrics and fashion. Next up, after 60 years, painting reattributed to Gainsborough. A portrait of a one-armed naval veteran has been attributed to Thomas Gainsborough, an 18th century painter. The work was sitting in storage for nearly 6 decades, and now Royal Museums Greenwich launched a campaign to raise 60,000 euros, at about 77 US, for conservation work on the painting and its frame so that it can be hung in the Queen's home next year. Again, that's coming from The Guardian, so read more upon that there. Nancy Yao withdraws from directorship. The former head of the New York-based Museum of Chinese in America will not be taking the helm as the founding director of the forthcoming America Women's History Museum in Washington, D.C. Yao said the reason was family issues. In April, the Smithsonian launched an investigation following claims that she mishandled sexual harassment allegations at her former position in New York. They always want to put it on the family when they, oh yeah, it's family obligation, got to step down. Man, well, you know what's going on. You're not fooling nobody. Art Market Hamptons postponed. The art fair held every year at affluent New Yorkers' favorite summer destination has been canceled this year and will return August 2024, citing unforeseen logistical issues. Artisma launches 2 new prizes for its anniversary. The Turin Fair returns in November for its 30th edition with 2 new prizes. One will be dedicated to a female dealer and another will grant a chosen artist an opportunity to create an original work for the famous Pista 500. The acquisitions fund, organized by Fondazione per l'Arte Moderna e Contemporanea. What are you saying? I don't even know. I guess there's an abbreviation here, CRT, in a different realm. CRT is that which shall not be spoken in a different realm. But for art, this is what in the art world, this is what they're talking about here. It has also been increased to The acquisition fund has been, it's up to $219,000. So that was from a press release. That's about you know, the happenings right there in the art world. In the quick roundup there, but I do want to focus a little bit on this story. So this billionaire collector Leon Black, he's accused of rape of a minor, with who? None other than Jeffrey Epstein. This happened apparently at Jeffrey Epstein's home. A federal lawsuit alleges that Leon Black, billionaire and prolific art collector, raped a 16-year-old girl in 2002 at the Manhattan townhouse of convicted sex offender Jeffrey Epstein. Deceased sex offender Jeffrey Epstein. According to the lawsuit filed in the U.S. District Court of Southern New York on Tuesday, the plaintiff, named in court documents as Jane Doe, was trafficked by Black, to Black by Epstein and his longtime partner, Ghislaine Maxwell, who was convicted also on sex trafficking charges. The lawsuit identifies the plaintiff, now in her 30s, as autistic. Doe was also born, so remember, they're calling her Jane Doe here, was also born with mosaic Down syndrome, a condition that includes significant intellectual delays and disabilities, the lawsuit says. Doe was able to sue Black under an amendment to a New York City law that allows lawsuits concerning gender-based violence to be filed within a two-year window that began in March 1, despite the statute of limitations. This is the same statute, I believe, that E. Jean Carroll's lawsuit against Donald Trump went through on, and she won that case, and it's been appealed, and the appeal went in her favor as well. Moving right along, Black's lawyer Susan Etheridge told the Washington Post that the lawsuit was frivolous and shared an email statement by Black's spokesman, which described the allegations as totally made up and entirely uncorroborated. Mr. Black has never met this individual, the statement continued. Black also faced other rape allegations, which he has denied. I mean, who gets, I mean, it's just multiple rape allegations from different people. Like, that's a lot of smoke for there not to be fire. I personally would, I would lean towards believing something like this after, several allegations, but that's just me. In May, a judge dismissed a former Russian model's lawsuit, which accused the former CEO of rape and defamation. Another woman also has accused Black of raping her in Epstein's home. Last week, the New York Times reported that Black paid $62.5 million to the U.S. Virgin Islands in January to avoid any potential legal action over his ties to Epstein. A spokesman for Black told the newspaper that the settlement contained no suggestion that Mr. Black was aware of or participated in any misconduct. Yeah, so I'm just going to give out $62.5 million just in case. That's a lot of just in case money there. Black settlement with the Virgin Islands does not cover claims by anyone else against Black, and the settlement cannot be used as evidence of wrongdoing by Black, according to the document. This is the third accusation of rape filed against Black, a trustee and the former board chair of the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and a recurring figure in the Art News Top 200 Collectors list. In a lawsuit filed in New York State Supreme Court last year, Cherry Pearson alleged that Black brutally raped her in 2002 at Epstein's Upper East Side home. Whitaker LLP, who represents Pearson, also represents Gazelle Geneva, a former model who in a March 2021 tweet accused Black of sexually harassing and abusing her for years. Geneva claimed that Black had mentioned Epstein's sexual proclivities multiple times and once flew her to Florida without her consent to satisfy the sex needs of Epstein, his best friend, according to Vanity Fair. I feel like a lot of people be calling Epstein their best friend. How many best friends did this guy have? I know he had a lot of socialites in around his in his orbit, and but everybody keeps accusing folks of being his best friend. Friends nonetheless, birds of a feather, I guess they all flock together. Black admitted to having a relationship with Geneva, but denied the rape accusation. In October 2021, Black sued the former model for defamation. In March 2021, amid mounting rumors of his connections to Epstein, Over 150 artists and activities signed. Is it artists? Do you even say activists? Maybe. Over 150 artists and it says activities, but I'm thinking it might say activists signed a petition asking MoMA to cut ties with Black. He subsequently stepped down as MoMA's board chair and as chief executive and chairman of the private equity firm Apollo Global Management Incorporated, which he led for 30 years. So yeah, that's in art news, and the guy's name is, you know, Leon Black. So look him up, and you know, people that are taking advantage of, particularly kids or anybody else for that matter, you make them famous, and they should not have a lot of these billionaires all the time. They have the benefit of anonymity. They could be walking next to you, you would never know, and so they can get away with, you know, all kinds of stuff, and they have the access and the power and the money to do that. But Leon Black, that's his name, accused rapist. I've never been accused of rape. And then you talk about being accused by multiple people, where there's smoke, there's fire, maybe. So it's all still alleged. For a book recommendation this time around, one fascinating book about art for adults is The Story of Art by E.H. Gombrich. This was first published in 1950. This book has become a classic in the field of art history and it's still widely read and admired by both art enthusiasts and professionals. The Story of Art presents an engaging, accessible, it's like a survey of the history of art from way like prehistoric times all the way to the modern era. Gombrich is a renowned art historian. He takes readers on a journey through various art movements, styles, techniques, provides insight and, you know, and commentary and analysis along the way as he takes you through this journey. What makes this book particularly appealing is Gombrich's ability to present complex art concepts in a clear and straightforward manner. He avoids overly technical jargon, making the book enjoyable for readers with any level of prior knowledge about art. Whether you're an art lover, a student of art history, or just simply curious about the evolution of human creativity expressed through the visual arts, The Story of Art is a must read that will enrich your understanding and appreciation of the art world. And now back to our artist of the day, Edvard Munch. He was born in 1863, died in 1944. He was a Norwegian painter and printmaker, considered one of the pioneers of expressionism in the 20th century. He's best known for his iconic painting, The Scream, which he drew in 1893. This has become a symbol of modern angst and existentialism. Edvard's upbringing was marked by personal tragedy and emotional difficulties, which greatly influenced his artistic development. He was born in Lawton, Norway, the second of five children. His father, Christian Munch, was a military doctor, while his mom, Laura, came from a wealthy merchant family. When Munch was only 5 years old, his mother died of tuberculosis. This loss had a profound impact on him and his siblings. Just 9 years later, his older sister, Sophie, she succumbed to the same disease at she was 15 at the time. These early experiences of loss and specter of death would become recurring themes in Munch's art. Following his mother's death, his siblings were primarily raised by their father, him and his siblings raised by their father. However, Christian Munch's strict religious beliefs and emotionally distant nature contributed to a challenging household environment. Munch once described his father as a ghost, and their relationship was strained. Despite these difficulties, Munch showed an early interest in art. He began drawing as a child and received encouragement from his father's colleagues who recognized his talent. In 1879, at the age of 16, Munch enrolled in a technical college to study engineering, as his father believed it would provide more financial stability. Typically, that's the way it works out. However, he soon realized that his true passion lay in art. In 81, he began studying at the Royal School of Art and Design in Oslo, where he received formal training in painting and drawing. Although he initially adhered to the academic style taught at the school, he eventually rebelled against it. The approach was too conservative, and he sought inspiration outside of the confines of that conservative tutelage. So some of the influences and inspirations. Well, of course, we mentioned he had a lot of death in his family. But during his time in Oslo, he was exposed to various artistic influences. He frequented cafes, museums, art galleries, immersing himself in the vibrant bohemian intellectual circles of the city. He interacted with other artists who were experimenting with new styles and techniques. Munch was particularly inspired by the work of the Symbolist movement and the innovative techniques of the French post-impressionists such as Paul Gauguin and Van Gogh. A decade later, Munch's art underwent a significant shift. Personal experiences of loss and grief, as we know, emotional turmoil, including the deaths of his mother and sister, deeply affected him. These experiences led him to develop a more personal and expressive style, which would later be associated with the Expressionist movement. Munch aimed to convey not only the visual representation of the external world, but also the inner emotional and psychological states of his subjects. Munch's work often incorporated symbolic elements expressing universal themes like love, death, obviously anxiety, and existential questions. He frequently depicted human figures, landscapes, and objects in a way that went beyond their literal representation, evoking a sort of deeper emotional resonance. His use of color was highly impressive and expressive and symbolic. He employed vibrant, non-naturalistic hues. High-end and emotional intensity of his works were displayed by, the brushstrokes. Some of them are quite rudimentary, but purposeful. For instance, he often used strong contrast of warm and cool tones, with fiery reds and oranges juxtaposed against cool blues or greens. Edvard's figures and landscapes often exhibited distortion and abstraction, reflecting the inner psychological states of his subjects. Faces might be elongated or stretched, hands and bodies contorted, and landscapes simplified or stylized. All of it aiming to capture the intensity of emotions rather than realistic representation. The artist frequently explored the same subjects across multiple works, creating series of paintings. So he would just like repeat them sometimes and just do the same, like even the screen. He did several renditions of that. Some had a crowd on that bridge. Of course, the famous one had the one screen with the guy looking, with the guy holding his face. I believe there was one where they had a guy in a bowler hat, I think, like staring off into the distance. And so he did different versions of that. So he would revisit these motifs, using them as a means of exploring different emotional and psychological variations. In addition to painting, Munch was also an accomplished printmaker. He experimented with various printmaking techniques, such as woodcutting, etching, lithography. Printmaking allowed him to reproduce his works and explore different effects and variations, expanding his reach and making his art more accessible. Today's Ekphrastic Poem is a retrospective on what is arguably Edvard Munch's most well-known iconic work that has become emblematic in this movement, and of course what I'm talking about is the screen. As a reminder, here's how this works. Remember, this is going to be a description of a visual art piece. As I'm speaking, I want you to visit the Ekphrastic page on my page, darwindarko.com. Check the show notes There should be a link there. On that site, you will find all this stuff cataloged for your viewing pleasure. To accompany today's reading, I want you to pull up the screen. It's a haunting figure on a bridge, capturing the intense emotional state of the artist and his sense, and has since become one of the most recognized paintings in the world. Munch created several versions of this painting using different mediums, including oil, tempera, and even pastel. I'll give you a second to search for it in your browser. Scream resounds through time and space in every hue and brushstroke that you trace. Amidst a world of fiery, swirling skies, a soul in turmoil stands, its essence bared, the scream, a visual symphony of cries. An artist's brush has etched emotions dared. The colors dance, emotions intertwine. In this masterpiece, a sacred shrine, a window to the soul's relentless fight. To comprehend the meaning of the night. Within this masterpiece of pain and fear, existential questions fill the air. What secrets lie within this soul so near? What demons dwell in depths of dark despair? A figure caught in anguish, face contorts against the backdrop of a vivid scene. The bridge connects two realms, two worlds, two ports. Where life and death collide, a space between.
A silent scream resounds through time and space.
The echoes of this scream, they resonate with all who've known the struggle and the strife. A universal cry, it finds its mate in hearts that beat the rhythm of this life. Yet hope persists amidst the chaos wild, for through the darkness light begins to gleam. A message in the scream, so reconciled, to find the strength to heal. To hope,
a silent scream
to dream.
Resounds through time and space, in every hue and brushstroke that you trace.
The scream, it's a powerful and iconic image that captures a sense of existential angst and emotional turmoil. The painting, featuring a figure with a distorted face against a swirling, vividly colored background, is believed to have been inspired by a personal experience of the artist. Standing on a bridge and witnessing a vivid sunset that left him feeling overwhelmed with anxiety and dread. Munch's innovative artistic style and subject matter challenged traditional conventions and paved the way for modern art movements such as German Expressionism and Abstract Expressionism. His exploration of psychological and emotional themes and his use of vivid colors and expressive brushwork had a profound impact on subsequent generations of artists. He is undoubtedly one of the pioneers of Expressionism, an influential artistic movement that emerged in the early 20th century. His exploration of subjective emotions, psychological states, and the use of distorted forms and vibrant colors greatly contributed to the development of the Expressionist aesthetics. Munch's works have achieved substantial market value, with his paintings often fetching high prices in art auctions. This recognition reflects the enduring appeal and cultural significance of his work. Additionally, he has received posthumous accolades, including retrospectives and exhibitions dedicated to his work, further solidifying his place in art history. The artist's legacy is preserved and celebrated through the presence of his works in major museums and exhibitions worldwide, notably the Munch Museum in Oslo. It houses the largest collection of his works, including paintings, graphic prints, and sculptures. Most people didn't realize that he actually had some sculptures. These institutions and exhibitions provide an opportunity for audiences to engage with Munch's art, again, further solidifying his lasting impact. Edvard Munch's legacy extends beyond his own time, as his profound exploration of human emotions, psychological depth, and expressive techniques continues to captivate and inspire audiences, ensuring his enduring relevance in the art world. You know, we painted another great picture today with our words, and I'm glad you took the time to join me on this journey. For this and other artwork we discuss, please visit the website darwindalpha.com/ekphrastic. It's where you can find all of this stuff cataloged for your viewing pleasure. If you like the show or if you want to leave some creative feedback, please rate us 5 stars. Still leave your feedback, but 5 stars would be lovely. And leave a comment. It's always helpful. Another great way to support the show is to share it with on your socials. Facebook, Twitter, there's threads now. Whatever, we'll take it. Speaking of which, we are on Twitter at The Ekphrastic. Instagram, same thing, The Ekphrastic. And YouTube, just search Ekphrastic Podcast. You can find us there. We'll find our way, and make sure you hit the like button and subscribe so that we can, you know, float our way up your timeline whenever we drop new content. I've been Darwin Messalu. Thanks again for listening to The Ekphrastic.